running at the beach. We always used to say to the guys who would see him on the regular streets, and say, we'll meet at the beach Sunday morning at 5 o'clock. Okay. So that's how we really got started. Until it got so big that we said, look, we better do something that's supervised and safe. So that's when I opened Half Moon Bay Drag Strip down the coast.
You know, the automobiles were just getting admitted to the fraternity of the man when I come in there. The early cars were junk boxes, like 19, 15, 20, terrible. But they woke them up pretty quick. And then they started improving the ride, improving the brakes. And then you really got some automotive engineers in there that improved the whole thing. And that's about when I could pick up and jump in there and do the same thing. Of course, we're doing it on so-called illegal mousetraps in the engine. But you know what? It's what they're doing in European racing today. It's worldwide. So we didn't have anything to beware of except the local police speeding. And I think the kids' records in that thing isn't bad at all. Of course, policemen like to make it bigger than it is. Makes them look good.
Well, I think it showed the people at Detroit a few things. They hired a number of ex-hot rodders, one of them in the design field. And, they hired two of Edelbrock's mechanics. Fran Hernandez was one of them. I think Bill Likes was another. And the Ford Motor Company hired Bill Strop, who used to build engines for people and was active in racing. And he was one of the fellows that worked with Clay Smith and Danny Jones. They kind of worked hand in glove with a lot of cars. So it did create some connection and some thinking. The fact that the fellows were doing this in such large numbers, Detroit couldn't ignore it. And the magazines probably helped too when Peterson started his first magazine. I can remember him and his partner, Lindsay, peddling the things with bags like the kids used to deliver the Saturday Evening Post. They were hawking them at Carroll's Speedway. And short time later, they're the bosses of the industry. They're telling Detroit what to do.
Well, the speed shops were doing a fantastic business. And of course we were too, because we were selling them advertising and they were selling their product all over the world by then. And little people that just had a little garage somewhere, they were now a business, and they had a nice building and were making product. They had advertising and PR, and they did the whole thing. So many people became millionaires right out of Hot Rod Magazine. I mean, I remember one kid came to me and he said, I got this little special carburation set up in a manifold for Chevys. And I said, well, that sounds pretty good. So I said, well, why don't you run a small ad and just get started? Well, he did, and Sonnyball became a millionaire out of just that little ad. He kept selling more and more manifolds, and he wasn't building a Ford deal, he was building something else. And it just caught on. Everybody wanted a story in Hot Rod Magazine because that, you know. And competition-wise, the person that got the cover or that got something else, that made his business soar. And we were selling at that time 750,000 copies on the newsstand, which is pretty fantastic. We had like a 95-98% sale through. Now if you have a magazine and you sell 50%, you're very, very good. We sold everything we put on the newsstands. It was just fantastic. And I didn't know how good it was. I mean, we didn't realize how good it was, but it just happened, you know. It was fantastic.
It's Americana. That's what I say it with. This is Americana. It started here, okay? And it's still here, and it'll be here for as long as people will go down there and pay, put their money up to go through the gate and watch it, you know? And you gotta admit, when you go there, if you don't know anything, even my chick, when I talk to her about this, and she says, you're right, you walk through the pit area or get up close to the starting line and you smell it, the tires, you smell the nitro, that stuff hooks you. I'm not kidding you. That really does. And all my friends who I've talked to over the years say, well, we're sitting there talking or something, God, I'd like to smell nitro now. God, we're all hooked on some sort of dope, and it happens to be a liquid thing in the can, you know.
Well, I'm just glad that I've lived this long to see what has happened to drag racing, which I really am the guy that started drag racing. Now there was other little short tracks up in San Galudi or something like that, that would race, but they didn't charge anybody. We're the first commercial drag strip that Creighton and I started. And thanks to Creighton, I owe him a lot of gold thanks for all the years that he's been my friend. You know.
My first hot rod was, Vic said one day, he says, well, kind of keep an eye on things, I've got to go somewhere. He says, I'll be back in a little bit. So he left, and he came back, and about 3 hours, and in the pickup truck was he says, come here, he says, I got some stuff you got to unload. So I went out there, and he had this Model T Roadster, all in pieces, in the back of this pickup. And he says, here's your first car, put it together. So that was my start.
Did you go, were you going to Bonneville every year in the 50s?
I went 49, 51, 2, 3, 4, I think. And my Arden engine had magnesium pistons in it. Now, nobody run magnesium pistons. What the hell? That's stupid. But I did because it was light. And when you lean out just a little bit, burn a hole in the piston. So instead of trying to fix it, well, I load up and come home. Next year, I'd go out, richen it up a little bit, do the same thing. But see, we didn't have any way of measuring at that time. We were taking a can of nitro and a can of methanol, 50-50, and dump it. That's what it was. Well, sometimes you got maybe it was 85% or 90%, and the next time you got was 100% nitro. Well, we didn't know that at the time. So we found out all this later on.